Shivani already introduced Jurgen Cox, and I think many people of you know who is this. I felt to say one small thing about Jurgen, just to add something personal to biography of the person. That's, you know, when I was a teenager, I was trained for javelin throwing. It's actually a really nice sport. And what was really super cool, that's my trainer also, you know, was throwing the javelin. He was showing how to do this. He was showing the details how to do this. And actually, you think about this, it's super exciting. And you know, I was super pleased to have a PI. Like, I had a supervisor who also basically doing the same thing and showing how to do this. So basically, Jurgen programming still, and kind of he actively programming MaxQuant. And so Jurgen, please.
Okay, glad I was useful for something, apparently. So let's start where we ended in the first session. And let me try to remember where we stopped. I think that we had already a question about reQuantify, but not the slide yet. Exactly. So let's start there then. So this is for the case where we have MS1 level labeling, for example, Silex labeling. And so then we have cases where we nicely put together light and heavy or light, medium, heavy features into pairs or triplets. But then we have other cases where we don't manage to do that. But still, we want to be able to calculate the ratio for those. And that's where this reQuantify comes in. So again, let's assume that we have found this isotope pattern here. And so for this isotope pattern, the machine acquired an MSMS spectrum here, for example, and this led to an identification. And from the identification, then we know that this is a heavy peptide, basically, right? And we know it's this specific peptide with this sequence and the heavy lysine. And we can identify the heavy lysine because for these particular MSMS that are sitting on isotope patterns that have not been matched together into pairs, for those we submit the labels as variable modifications, right? So we offer both alternatives, being a heavy or a light peptide, and then from the identification we know it's a heavy peptide. But that means that we then also know where the light partner is supposed to be if it's actually occurring with the signal, and we particularly look then into these places where the light partner for this heavy peptide is supposed to be found. And indeed, in this case, we do see a signal here. And then we put this then out also into these integration boundaries, and we can just proceed with the quantification of this feature just the same way as for the feature pairs that we found in the first place. And we get the ratio for these. And so so one has to say a couple of things about these reQuantify ratios. And that also should give you a guideline if you want to use that or not. So when do you want to use these reQuantified ratios? It's so always in cases where you are looking for what are outlier ratios, so what are high ratios, but you don't need the specific value of the ratio. So for you, it's not important that the ratio is exactly 1 to 20, for example, but you're also happy if it's reported as being 1 to 10 or something. You just want it to be outlier, right? Then this is a good thing to do. However, if you rely on the precision of the actual ratios, then you should not use reQuantify, because it tends to underestimate ratios, because it always quantifies something that is really apparent as an isotope pattern against something that is just coming out of the noise, right? So there's always a tendency that because of that, you underestimate the ratio, right? So you should keep that in mind. Right, so then we have quantified all of our ratios. Now here you see the ratios from one LCMS run in log space. So these are logarithmized ratios and also plotted against log intensity of the complete feature. And then you see here that in this case we actually ended up with two subpopulations of the ratio, right? So you see clearly the light blue and dark blue populations, which is especially at high intensity, you see that they really have different means, these populations. And so so what are these populations? So this is actually lysine-labeled and arginine-labeled peptides, right? So they get slightly different biases because of biases in the purity of the amino acids that you're using for the labeling. And so the important takeaway is here that one has to use normalization of the ratios if one wants to get more precise than this bias between these populations, right? And one has to do the normalization here at the peptide level already, because, so these are peptide ratios. If we now average them or take the median over proteins, then at that stage, it's not possible to remove that error anymore, right? So one has to do it here. And it's done. So essentially, it's removing the or putting the log mean of the ratios to zero. And that's what is written into the columns in the output tables that are called normalized ratios. So you might have seen that. You have, for MS1 level labeling, you have columns that are called ratios. Obviously, that these are the ratios. And you know from this morning that this is not intensity heavy divided by intensity light, but something more complicated than that. And you have next to that usually columns called normalized ratios, and that's exactly those where the median of populations, of subpopulations, for example, lysine and arginine containing peptides, is subtracted, right? So that's why it's normalized ratios. And it's again some kind of normalization that that's based on the assumption that the whole population is not showing changes, right? So that's only valid in cases where the the proteins that are actually showing differential expression is a minority in the whole sample, right? So if more than 50% would be changing, then this kind of normalization doesn't make sense to be applied to the data. Okay, so we can also take questions in the middle of the talk if you feel like, right? But we can also wait for the end. But then, yeah, we have to chase people with the microphones through the room.
So you can, in cases where you have infinite fold changes, and if you apply the requantifier rule, of course, you end up with a finite fold change, right? Because it's probably integrating some noise that is present in the other channel. So if you then don't use the requantify feature in that particular case, what does then MaxQuant still report the ratios, or would that?
So in cases where you have infinite ratio, you say, so then it doesn't report the ratio. So then one would typically deal with this at later stages outside of MaxQuant. So for example, in the Perseus software, you might then want to deal with that by imputation. But then it depends on the specific nature of the experiment, because imputation is usually only a good concept if you can, for example, say the ratio is not there most likely because something was not there or low abundant, right? Which would be the case in the scenario that you described, but it's not always the case for SILEC or MS1 labeling experiments. So it's typically the case if you quantify everything against a common reference. So then you can go on with imputation, and we will actually see that in the exercises later.
But that kind of comes to the question whether to use matching as a feature or to impute would.
Yeah, so it's not either or. It can also be both, actually. So I think for both, one has to make decisions always, right? And so the matching is always a good strategy if you're comparing similar samples to each other. So if the samples are within the same study, very related, then matching is usually a good way of expanding your features, right? But if you start matching samples that have nothing to do with each other, then you're probably doing something wrong already. So that one should avoid, basically, right? So, but then independent of you did or did not matching, you still need to do or not need to do imputation. So that's really two independent questions. And so there, for imputation, the question is always, is it a good assumption that if something is not present, it's because it really wasn't there or is low abundant, right? Or are there other reasons why it's not there? So.
And then in terms of using the normalization, also in this case as well as in the case of LFQ normalization, when you say that you assume that the samples are similar to each other, and that's when you would use normalization, how similar do they need to be? Because this is something that you don't know beforehand, right? In many cases, or in some cases you know about it.
Yeah, so I mean, that's a common question to all of these methods that have the assumption that on average nothing changes, right? But then the specific answer might be different for specific methods. And so for LFQ, we really have this criterion, which might sound a bit crazy, that so if it runs through, if it managed to normalize, it's fine, just go ahead. And if it's too different, then it will actually, the algorithm will actually fail. Okay, so then we have normalized the peptide ratios here in the MS1 level labeling. And I just mentioned already now, so what we do for the proteins, so it's actually, so what you do on protein level for quantification, so the step from peptides to proteins in quantification is actually quite different for the different types of labelings, right? So for LFQ, for example, this is this rather complicated normalization scheme that we use, the MaxLFQ algorithm that will be covered later. For MS1 level labeling, we like to take the median of the quantified features. And here, so it's again median because of the robustness of the median, meaning that some of them are completely off, doesn't matter, median doesn't care. That's why we prefer that. I mean, the other alternative one might think about would be the weighted mean, right? Because you would think that things that are high abundance should have a more precise measured ratio, but that's not always true because something can be high abundant and still wrongly identified, for example. I mean, you always deal with 1% false positives and so on. So that's why that's not such a great assumption. That's why it turns out empirically that it's actually good to take the median of these features. Right, so that's the protein ratios. So now we're getting closer to this question of matching features. So the prerequisite of matching, of transferring identifications by matching mass and retention time is, of course, that we have precise values for the masses and precise values for the retention times.
Sorry, we have to go back in time here for 30 seconds. About the ratios here, peptide ratios. Even though we're taking the median, is there any way to get out the like the standard deviation for the peptide ratios?
If you but you're talking now averaging peptide ratios to protein ratios, right?
On this protein level. Ratios, yeah.
In principle, one could, but then the question is what would you want to do with it? Because I think it's actually, so if you want to use it for filtering, I'm not sure if that's really the best way of doing it, because then it's actually better to immediately go one step further and do the hypothesis testing and do the filtering there, right? So for example, variance filtering could be one step before you go into differential expression. Is that that plan or what?
Yeah.
But then you could also just as well do it in one step. I mean, you can just go into the t-test or whatever you're using with the non-variance filtered data, because there you compare then the variances to the group means, and so you're anyway dealing with the variances. And so we usually prefer to do this in one go and not with an intermediate variance filtering in between. Okay, so now we want to match features. That's the goal, and for that we need to make sure that the retention times are comparable between LC-MS runs. So we already took care of the masses. So the masses are recalibrated. They have small mass windows. They have high accuracy, so they are really good to go for the matching. Retention time, not yet. So they have to be aligned and. For that, so we already mentioned as response to some questions that there are actually two time windows for doing this alignment. So one is the alignment time window, I think it's called, and this is basically setting the scale in which MaxQuant looks for alignment at all, right? So it just tries to see where actually data points that fit together and that should be aligned eventually. And so this is big. So this is something on the order of 10 minutes or something like this. So basically as big as your worst alignment error could be, right? And then, but then you have another window which is applied after the alignment where you basically say, okay, what is actually the actual time window in seconds in which the alignment takes place, right? So these are two different things. And so here we are still dealing with this first window, because so here now you see after matching features between two LCMS runs with a huge time window, we see that there is this data cloud appearing which has a big nonlinear effects on a scale of minutes. And so what you see basically in this plot is exactly the alignment curve that you want to apply to one of the LCMS runs to make it comparable to the other LCMS run, right? So that's how we determine the curve, basically determine the backbone of this high density point cloud to determine the alignment function. And that's of course not limited to having two LCMS runs, but it can be as many as you like. And so they're basically then, this alignment function is then calculated pairwise on pairs, but not on all pairs, but it's guided by a similarity tree. So the samples are clustered in a similarity tree, and then this cluster is then used to guide the alignment process. So we have only n minus one alignments and not n squared, and all of your LCMS runs will then be comparable to each other after this alignment. And then, so once the retention time alignment is done, so now you can actually go ahead and transfer identification. So meaning, for example, that in this case, you have an identification of this LCMS feature in run two, but you have no identification in a feature with the same mass and same retention time within the windows that we specify. You have no identification for that one. So then you matching between runs does nothing else but transferring the identification from this to that one, and also vice versa. So this is then always can go in both directions, basically, this matching, right? And so this can easily double the number of features that that you can use for quantification. So the thing one has to be careful about, so this run one and run two, this should be really similar samples, right? So this should be same study, same, background, so that you really can be sure that what you match over is also the same peptide. Right, and then once we have that, we are ready to do also, so it's also of course good for MS1 level labeling, but for label-free quantification it's probably even more important that you do this. And so how this is then applied in label-free quantification we will anyway see in a later talk. But let me also mention, so for label-free it's useful, for MS1 features it's useful and also done already in MaxQuant, but in principle also for quantifying MSMS it's useful, for TMT like quantification it's useful, because this can actually also transfer the identification to an MSMS spectrum that has not been identified but which still has reporters that could be read out, right? So that's also something that it's useful for, and that actually comes in the next version, I think. Okay, so that was quantification. Now we're actually jumping back to identification of peptides. Yeah.
I have actually a question to the match between runs function. You said that the samples must be very similar here. What actually does this mean? So when I do, for example, two experiments, but with the same setup, but on different days and
This is still similar. So you should not start matching cellular proteomes into plasma proteomes or things
like that. Yeah.
Or yeast proteomes into human proteomes or something like this. So,
it depends only on the setup. So if this is equal.
Yeah, so the technological setup, like the retention time or chromatography is different. That's usually acceptable within very large limits, basically. And Yeah, so it's just not, you can also not match every human sample to every other human sample, right? So that's definitely without not in the bounds of validity anymore. But it's usually, so what you study together in one project, so this is typically similar enough to do the matching.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so back to the identification of peptides. So we saw already in the talk from Petra this morning how the Andromeda search engine works, but there's actually then more behind it. So we already saw a little bit about Fossier error probability and things like this. So first of all, we are using the target decoy approach, and we use this automatically. So you don't have to take care of that and produce decoy database yourself, but that's all done within MaxQuant. And so what is this actually? So the decoy database is something you put on top of your actual database, so that might be, for example, all human protein sequences. And now you want to put in the same amount of protein sequences as your real sequences, however, which do not really exist in your sample. So we are sure that they don't exist. And so one way of ensuring this is that you just take the reverse of all the sequences in the protein database that you're using. So that's also what is done in MaxQuant typically. Alternatives would be randomized. You could also use randomized sequences. However, this is slightly problematic because you can actually distinguish random protein sequences from real protein sequences just by the correlations between local correlations between amino acids. And so one important rule for creating decoy databases is it should not be easy for you to say that this is a decoy sequence, right? And so it's actually harder for the reverse sequences. I mean, of course, if you now look at motifs that are not reversible, you would also maybe be able to spot that. But so that's probably the best one can do, and it's also sufficient for most practical purposes. So what we prefer is to use reverse sequences for this decoy database here, right? And then you make a competitive search of all of your data against these two databases. Many will end up as scoring, having a top score to the forward database. Some will end up having top score to the decoy database. And the distributions of these two will then allow you to judge how many false positives do you have in your forward results, right? Because you make this competition between two same size sequence sets, one of them correct, one of them wrong. It's kind of a good assumption to say that the number of hits that you get in the reverse database, that should actually be the same number as the wrong ones in your forward database. So that's how you estimate the FDR with the target decoy approach. And it's good assumption that breaks down only if you really try to break it down. So that's what we use. And also, making use of these two distributions, the forward and reverse, we calculate the posterior error probability, right? So Petra was already mentioning it. This is just this conditional probability that given an Andromeda score, what is the probability that this was a wrong identification, right? And so the nice thing is that one can make this dependent on many other parameters, so not just the database score itself, but also on the peptide length, on the number of modifications, on the number of miscleavages, and the charge. And so why would one do that? Because, for example, if you have a solution, a PSM, that, however, would require many, many miscleavages, then this is already suspicious, right? So then it's actually, if you have a solution that scores just as well with no miscleavages, then this one is actually the one that is more likely to be the correct, even if they have the same score, right? So it's good for integrating all of these properties into the identification process, also makes data comparable. And so it's actually very similar in what it achieves to what also Percolator, other software are doing. So it's just another way of doing the same, basically. And what it also is very useful for is now if you analyze heterogeneous data. So if you throw together, for example, SILAC and label-free data or TMT data, then all of these are not, so the identifications from these data sets are not really comparable to each other. And so let's say you want to throw them together for you to identify proteins. You want to identify proteins together from a SILAC and a label-free and a TMT data set. Then it's actually non-trivial how these peptides actually go together to identify these proteins. Right? So you first have to make them comparable. And that's exactly what the posterior probability also does. So since we calculate the posterior probability separately in these sub-data sets, like, for example, different labeling techniques or different fragmentation techniques, since we do that separately and then actually make them comparable again by normalizing them to each other, we can then analyze all of this data together and make use of it for a single protein identification process, right? So it actually achieves quite a lot of things. So if we wouldn't have that plugged behind the Andromeda search, many things would not work in Max Quant, actually. So that it's a very crucial thing. Okay, so this is how the posterior error probability is calculated on the PSM level, and from this you also get the false discovery rate estimate. So essentially by now using the posterior error probability as our new ranking number and doing the cutoff with whatever percentage of false positives we specify. But then you can also, so that's how we do it on the PSM level, but then we can also do it on other levels, right? So for example, one can apply a false discovery rate on the peptide level. So that's different from the PSM level because one peptide might be identified with many PSMs, more than one. Then you can do it on the protein level. And so here you have a many-to-many connection between the peptides and proteins because obviously every protein has several peptides, but also goes the other way. A peptide can be non-unique and can map to several protein groups, right? So so you can do it on the protein level. And you could also do it on the gene level. So that would then be collapsing multiple proteins that come from the same gene location into one entity, right? And then one would do it on the gene level. Right, so what is done in Max Quant is, so we have a two-level false discovery rate control. So it's done on the PSMs, on the peptide spectrum matches, as I previously described, with the help of the posterior error probability. So there we then usually cut at 1%. That at least, of course, this is not hard-coded, that you can set as a user, but that's kind of the default setting. And what we then do next is the protein grouping, because then so we have to get the redundancy of protein sequences out. So that we don't over-report the number of proteins that we identify, because many of the proteins that are in the FASTA file might actually share the same peptides that you identify and are not distinguishable based on what you're measuring. And so these are should be actually then put together into protein groups. And so that's what we do in this next step. And so once this is done, we would then typically apply a protein group FDR on this. And so the standard setting for that would also be 1% FDR, and so there are some subtleties we have to discuss on the next slides. And that, of course, also depends a bit on what you do. So I'm always talking on the typical proteomics experiments where you want to do protein expression profiling. Of course, if you do peptidomics or other things, then you might not specify these particular two-tier FDRs, but for, again, 99% of the cases, that's probably a good thing to do here. Okay, so how do we exactly apply the protein FDR? So first we calculate the protein score, and so this is just the product of the peptide posterior error probabilities, but then making sure that you take only one per peptide sequence. So if a sequence is identified multiple times, it still goes only in with one posterior error probability into this number, right? So that's the product of these. Actually, the logarithm, I think, in the end, doesn't really matter. And so then these are ranked, and you take proteins until you have one or the specified number of false positives in your list, basically. Right, so this is done after the cutoff on the peptide posterior probability, right? Which means, so because you also then lose, actually in this step, again peptides. So those peptides that only belong to proteins that don't make it into this 1% FDR protein list. So these peptides will also be gone. They will be filtered out of all of the tables. Which is the reason why, in the end result, if you apply both of these, your peptide FDR, your PSM FDR, is actually better than this 1% that you started with, because we do some post-filtering based on the proteins that survive, right? Okay, so in the end, you get a quite a sure list of things that that is in the sample, basically. Okay, so then, that's how we apply the protein FDR. And here you just see that it's really important to do the protein FDR, at least if you want to count how many proteins you can identify, then it's actually unavoidable that you have to apply a protein FDR as well. Because here you see what happens if you don't, or if you use different levels of protein FDR. So this already all, so these are five data sets of different sizes, and so they all have already been filtered with PSM FDR at 1%, right? So you might think, okay, that's good. I've done my filtering and I just start counting proteins now. However, that's not a good idea, because so what you see here is, so now on this axis here, you have the number of protein groups that you identify, and on this axis you have the Q value. So this is essentially the FDR. So if you cut at a certain Q value, let's say 1%, Q value 1%, so this is going to be the FDR in your data, protein FDR in your data set, right? And then you see, so if you apply or not apply this this Q value cutoff or FDR on protein level, the number of proteins that you are going to report from your study can vary between 20,000 and 100,000, which is quite a big difference, right? So it just goes to show that it's really important to apply protein FDR if the number of proteins is somehow the result of your study, right? So then one should do that. Yeah, another thing to consider is, what do we actually do with peptides that map to multiple proteins in this peptide-to-protein mapping, but also in the protein filtering and protein FDR process. So there are several possibilities. So one, peptides that occur multiple times, you could just discard them. That would probably be the most stringent way of working, but it's also not recommended really for organisms that have a lot of alternative splicing, because this will be full of splice variants that maybe you can just distinguish by one peptide, but which does for your study not really have a functional difference. And you don't want to lose all of these peptides that can distinguish or that are in common then between these splice variants, right? So even though that might seem to be the more stringent approach, or however you would call it, you just lose a lot of information if you do it like this, right? Then the other extreme would be that you use the non-unique peptides everywhere. You use it multiple times, but that's also unfair, because then that way, if you have one peptide that occurs in whole protein family of 100 proteins or something like this, then you could say, oh, I've identified these 100 proteins. And by the way, they all have the same ratio, right? But that's, of course, also not correct, right? So a good compromise is then this this razor peptide approach, where you make sure that you use every peptide only in one protein group. So you use it only once for identifying a protein group, and you also use it only once for quantification. And then so it's of course a heuristic rule, and it consists of always putting the peptide into the protein group that has already the most peptides or the most unique peptides already in it, right? Because that's the easiest explanation for the existence of this peptide, right? So this is just for showing that doing this razor way of doing the protein FDR, or using peptides multiple times, this also has a huge effect, or can have a huge effect, on identification number. So in this case, it's actually changing by 3,500 proteins that you identify more if you don't use this razor approach. But use peptides multiple times for protein identification, right? So has to be aware of this effect as well. Okay, so time-wise, how are we doing? So maybe we take questions, actually. So.
Well, a few questions, but first of all, thank you.
Thank you for the talk. Can you maybe explain again how this Q value is constructed exactly? Because I don't get how you can get a higher percentage from by multiplying values that are all lower than 1%.
Yeah, so Q value is just FDR, right? So it's actually the same. It's just you call it Q value if you don't specify it and enforce it, but you leave it open, right? So it's essentially like you leave the FDR open, and so basically we just calculate. I mean, this is just based on counting forward and reverse hits on the protein level, and it's essentially just the ratio of forward and reverse hits. As you would do it, you just don't cut it, I mean, for the whole table, but you leave it open, and there's just a column with this value, which means that if you use a certain threshold, like 1% on this, then this is going to be your FDR, basically. Is that answering your question, or not? Well, partially.
Thank you. I was just wondering, when we are setting up MaxQuant search, why is it in default state that we put for modified peptides Andromeda scored 40, and for unmodified peptides we put its default is zero? And
yeah.
How does it then calculate posterior probability?
Yeah, so these are basically additional thresholds. So you could just put them all to zero, and an FDR calculation would still be correct. So these are additional thresholds that you want to apply to ensure some minimum quality of the spectrum. And so why is it different for modified and unmodified peptides? It's just because as soon as you're talking about a modified peptide, you're also interested in localization of this modification and things like this. So then it's usually not enough to just say, okay, this is somehow existing and modified, but we don't know anything else. But then you really want to know more about the modification and where it's sitting on the peptide. So you have some higher requirements to the spectrum if you have modified peptides. That's the only reason why we put a threshold there.
More question? Okay, I have one small thing, actually. If you take triptych peptide and there's a, let's say, arginine at the end, and when you're making reverse peptide, is it true that arginine going to be on the first position?
No, that's not true. I was not telling the truth, I must say. So it's not just reversing. It's mainly reversing, but we keep the arginine. So the amino acids are responsible for the cleavage. We keep them on the same places, basically, so that we really have the same. So, I mean, only that way you actually get exactly the same properties from the forward and the reverse database. Good point.
I knew answer. Sorry. Okay. So thank you, Jürgen, for nice presentation. Mm-hmm.